In the early 1940s, psychoanalyst René Spitz reported on the importance of the basic needs of infants, needs of touch, security, and even emotional support. While, of course, food, nutrition, and hygiene were grave importance, she concluded high death rates of those infants, whether in low or even high income homes that receive food and hygiene, but not the necessities of touch, security, and emotional support. Many years later in his research, Harry Balkwin concluded that those who did not receive this caused harm to their well-being. Without love and attention and support and security, they would be categorized in the umbrella description of failure to thrive. Conditions ranging from growth delay, misery, even death. As new babes entering into the faith, Paul writes them to let them know that there would be emotional support, constant love, security, so that growth in faith would not be stumped, or even worse, that spiritual death could happen. Not just given support to them by God, but to each other in communal living. Paul is writing during a time where the persecution of the early Christians are at an all-time high. Stephen has been martyred. James has been beheaded. And Nero's persecutions are imminent. Christians would suffer at the hands of the world, dominated by flesh. Paul begins our passage today by making a contrast between two ways of living. And those two ways have also two outcomes. To live according to the flesh, according to selfishness, ends with death, while living by the power of the Spirit leads to life. And Paul, when he mentions flesh, or as the translation says, selfishness, he's not talking about what's on our bones. He's using the Greek word sarx, the metaphor for the human tendency to seek or to possess all that brings immediate or imminent satisfaction to one's self that would negate their spiritual growth. Selfishness. This consequence is death. Now, many argue what type of death Paul is addressing. For some, it's not necessarily a physical death, but surely a spiritual death. Paul shifts and uses familial and household imagery to further indicate the obligation and allegiance. He contrasts being a child with being a slave. And the phrase sons of God had resonance both in Greco-Roman and in Jewish context. The former was for emperors and heroes who were labeled as such, and the latter for the people of Israel who who were referred to as sons of God. Being a child, in contrast to being a slave, afforded one a different privileged status. See, children, even adopted children, were afforded intimacy, status, freedom, and high-status Roman households. Their social relationship were ordered by free and not forced obligation. And this intimacy is indicated by the fact that the believers cry out, Abba, Father, as it's the translation of Aramaic, Father. This familial closeness, not as a childish way of referring to a parent, but to contrary to popular belief, this word was used by children and adults. We share in these first aspects of this Trinity as being children calling out God, Abba, calling out God. And the thing is, in ancient times, slaves and children both referred to their master and parent as Abba. The difference is one was regarded into a parental aspect, while the other was in regards to the head of a state. And so, through Paul's pneumatology, it is no longer an Abba that enslaves us with fear, but one that calls out as heirs. And if joint heirs with Christ, then we have a sharing and dwelling with the Spirit, carrying out the legacy and promises of God into a generous community. We are children of God not because of the decisions we make regarding being selfless or selfishness, but because we are children of God, our choices should be made that is selfless. Because we are children of God, because we have been invited into the fold, beloved, then we are invited to share into a gratitude and a generosity. Life becomes an act of communal living and giving, even when it may not directly affect us. In the early 1970s, Angie, who was 10, and her little sister, Bird, who was 8, became fascinated with the idea of smoking. All of their favorite actors and actresses did it, and they would watch even their parents as they inhaled and exhaled the smoke, seeing uncles and aunts playing cards and dominoes as cigarettes hung from their lips. And they became mesmerized to the point that they wanted to try it out for themselves. So they waited till a Saturday when both their parents were taking a nap. They slowly grabbed this pack of cigarettes off the kitchen table, and they thought the best place to do it would be the car, because no one would notice. Now, some of you all will remember those old school push lighters in the car. They pushed the lighter, they touched the cigarette, they heard the sizzle, and they put it to their lips and instantly began to choke, wondering why anyone in the world would do this. But they were so fascinated. If their actors, their favorite actors and actresses would do it, if their parents were doing it, there had to be some type of appeal to it. So they sat there continuing in the car. Well, all of a sudden, Angie's little sister dropped the cigarette in between the seat, and all they saw was the little haze of smoke begin. They begin to get nervous and to throw out the trash under all the seats, trying to find the cigarette, but it was too late. A flame began. The carpet had caught on fire. They went inside, grabbed a pot of water, and threw it, but the flame became bigger and bigger until all they could do was run into the house and yell, "Fire!" And instantly their parents got up. But it was too late. The fire had consumed the car so badly that they had no idea what to do next. All of a sudden, neighborhood kids began to walk up to look at the fire, but the parents of the two young girls were worried that the car might explode, and so they tried to move the children away. They tried to tell them to go back home to be safe, but the kids could not let go of the orange and red flames dancing in front of them. So the parents got an idea. They lined up all the children and they passed down pots and they would begin to throw water, passing the pots, throwing water, passing the pots down, throwing water, until finally they heard the shh. And seeing the flames die, Angie's mom got in the car and thought maybe, just maybe, the ignition would start up. And it did. And so for them, their biggest worry was not about if they would drive the car or not. They were going to definitely do that. But it was, how do they recover all that was inside of the car? They took out all the seats. They called many places to see if they could get new seats and carpet to install in the car for themselves, junkyards even, but they said it would be weeks. And all of a sudden, different neighbors began to bring down the street benches, even fabric so that they can make seat belts out of it. Little chairs with cushions on it that they could still sit on to drive. This is the 70s, y'all, just so y'all know. It's not, this is not today. The community formed together to give even when it did not directly affect them, to see the flourishing of their community in the best ways possible. My question to you is, what can you bring to the car? I'm not saying before you get the thought that the church is burning up or caught on fire. That is not the idea at all. But how do we become a generous community together, offering the needs, the support that goes in these walls and even outside of these walls? Because the gift of giving is part two of the generous legacy of Christ. And if we are heirs of Christ, that means that we continue to flow and do the motions and perspectives and ideologies of Christ too, not just through our mouths, not just lip service, but even with our hands and our giving of our time, of our talents, and yes, our tithe. This is one of those giving sermons, and because it's not everybody here, I want to make sure y'all pass this sermon around to everybody that y'all know. But in all seriousness, there are times that we neglect the opportunity to be generous, to bring what we need in order for us to thrive together, so that there is support, emotional and physical. Throughout our lives, we find ourselves being generous. And through our generosity, it's most of the time through what we are grateful for. We're generous with our time and money and service and even stretching out of our comfort zones with our theologies and the ways of our thinking. Whether that means we give because we're grateful for a God who supplies grace greater than our sins. We give because of beautiful music that's offered. We give because of youth and children and support and curriculum and camps. We give so that missional opportunities continue to happen right here in Dallas and all over the world with our partners. We give, and there are great side effects when we are generous people. Generous through our presence and serving, we realize that we are a better community of faith together. When we gather in worship and in Bible study and in fellowship, we move from being disengaged members to those who are actively engaged in all facets of the church. And as Christians, when we serve, we are ready to put ourselves in action and not to hold back. We are not hesitating to ask ourselves, where will you give yourself to service for each other, for the kingdom of God together? And when we're generous with our growing, we are shaped by the Spirit of the living God, shaped by the Word of God, that we're staying limber in our thinking and in our listening to the still small voice of God. Can I just tell you, one of the most holy moments that I've seen recently was just today. In the midst of a holy hiccup, that watching as we had an impromptu Sunday school class in the chapel, and we're hearing about the Spirit of God coming to Elijah in a still small voice of silence. That through our generous acts of being going with the flow too, we're able to see the Spirit of God in such different ways than when we've even planned for it to happen. One writer states that to be present, growing and serving but not giving is like dragging your leg over the edge of a canoe and wondering why the boat isn't moving faster. We must also be generous in our giving, not just of ourselves, but also financially. We carry out the legacy of Christ through our generosity. As heirs, we are witnesses, we are harbingers of hope, we are gifted, and we choose to gift too. Through adoption, we now know a radically new source of for our life and our being. And through our selflessness, we are able not only to find new life, but to give new life too. New life to different aspects of our church. New life in ministries. New life in missional engagement. New life in curriculums. Can I just be honest? New life too in our children and youth and camps and VBS. The summer is the most expensive time of the year. It is also the time of the year that we drop the lowest in our generosity. We need all hands. Have you seen this place during VBS? It's crazy. But my goodness, is it holy. So may we give. May we be generous with our lives. May we find moments in bringing the fabric for the seat belts, the benches for the back seat, the extra seats for the front and the passenger side. And may we get in and may we drive the car, showing off how community works. That it's not just one of us, but it takes each of us and all of us. That as heirs of Christ, we live into having hearts that are generous, having hearts that is grateful, having hearts of Christ to support and to live not for self, but for each other. Amen.